Joseph Fairbanks and I had been old friends. We'd met in our freshman year at medical school, and through our internship and on into our practicing years, our friendship had grown. Joseph had gone on to become one of the nation's outstanding surgeons, and I had enjoyed no small success as a heart specialist. Perhaps you've heard of me. Carl Winston? Oh, well, no matter. To go on, neither Joseph nor I had ever married. So consequently, as we'd grown older, we'd sought each other's company more and more to fill the lonely hours of our bachelor life. When our virile days had passed and the contentment for just sitting before an open fire and sipping brandy had come upon us, we'd slacked off on our social encounters. But we'd still made it a point to visit each other's homes once a week, on Friday nights. I remember last night so clearly, coming up the winding road that led to the old mansion where Joseph lived alone with his manservant for my regular Friday night visit. I remember the cold white moon and the old house silhouetted against the glowing sky, and I remember the sudden chill that shot up my spine, the sudden fear. Although why I should have been frightened of anything at that point, I will never know. It was a ritual I'd gone through 100 times before. Joseph would meet me at the door. "Come in, come in, Carl, come in," he would always say. "Good evening, Joseph," I would answer. "How have you been this past week?"
"Fine, fine. Give me your hat and muffler and go make yourself comfortable."
He'd nod toward the roaring fire and the two high-back plush chairs he'd always have pulled up, waiting. Since neither Joseph nor I had any families or close relatives, we'd arranged our wills so that if one of us died, the other would inherit his estate, which would amount to a pretty penny, since each of us had made a great deal of money in our lifetime. But I digress from the story.
"Will it be the usual, Carl?"
he would say when he'd put away my things.
"Brandy?"
"That would be fine, Joseph. Ah, the fire feels good tonight. This damp weather always settles in my bones," I'd start the small talk. And that would be the evening. Quiet, simple, just two friends getting together for small talk on a Friday evening. Usually it would be very pleasant, except for when Joseph would bring up that silly theory of his, and we would begin to argue again about it. We always argued about it.
"But actually, Carl, how do we know? How sure can we be that a man is really dead?" he would ask. "Who is to say that he cannot still feel, still hear, still see what is going on around him?"
"He cannot, my dear Joseph," I would answer, "because his heart has stopped beating. The blood no longer flows to his brain. The cells die for lack of oxygen, and you are enough of a doctor, even in your senility, to know that a dead brain cell is incapable of receiving stimuli. I think the older we'd gotten, the more childish we'd become about this continuous disagreement over Joseph's ridiculous theory. We'd come to fight about it, the way children fight about who's to be it in a game of tag."
But that's just the point, Carl,"
he'd wave a gnarled finger at me.
"Suppose the brain cells do not die minutes after the heart stops beating. Suppose they continue to live for hours, yes, even days after the heart stops. Then what?"
But we know that the brain cells cannot last for 15 minutes without oxygen, I'd reason.
In their normal state, yes, he'd agree. But suppose that at the moment of heart cessation, whether through body injury or simple failure, suppose the brain cells go into a state of shock, of reduced metabolism.
Reduced metabolism? I'd scoff. Shock? How ridiculous!
Ridiculous? No!
He'd insist.
Possible. Very possible. In a state of shock, where the functions of the brain cells are curtailed, the little oxygen left in the protoplasm at the moment of heart failure would be enough to prolong the life of the cell for hours.
So, a dead man, according to your theory, is not really dead when he's pronounced dead, eh? I'd laugh. He can still feel, see, and hear, although he cannot move. Is that what you're saying, Joseph?
That's what I'm saying, Carl.
He'd nod.
Just think of the countless corpses you've seen whose eyes are still open until they are thoughtfully pressed closed with pennies or wads of cotton. Think of the horror.
He'd go on.
The horror of having your eyes forced shut and held shut when your eyes can still see.
This theory of yours is sheer poppycock, I'd say. I will not hear any more.
Think of the horror of listening to your blood being pumped out of your body, of embalming fluid being forced in.
He'd ignore my threat.
Think of the excruciating pain, and think of having to listen to your own funeral ceremony, Carl, of feeling the closeness of the coffin, the lid being slammed shut, perhaps nailed.
Stop it, Joseph. I'd almost shout.
Think of how it would be to feel yourself being lowered into your grave, Carl. The thumping of earth being shoveled down on top of you.
He'd rave on.
And then, and only then, really dying.
It would go on like that until I could not stand it any longer. Until I would leap from my seat and shout, "Good Lord, Joseph, enough! Enough already! I shall leave your house this minute if you persist in continuing this ghoulish conversation." As I said before, Joseph and I were just like a couple of kids. I'd have to threaten not to play in order to get him to stop his nonsense. The rest of the evening would be pleasant, though, and we'd part the best of friends once more. But last night, I'd had that sudden premonition. That sudden chill, as if last night was to be different.
Will it be the usual?
Joseph said when he put away my things.
Brandy?
Brandy would be fine, Joseph. I nodded. Yes, last night was different. Very different. We sat before the roaring fire, Joseph and I, sipping our brandies and making small talk. And he didn't once bring up his ridiculous theory. Instead, he talked of investments and bad luck and some such drivel while I waited gleefully, not paying much attention to what he was talking about. You see, I'd thought of a new argument against his theory, and I was mulling it over in my mind.
So you see, Carl, I'm bankrupt. I'm stone broke. I haven't a dime.
I swallowed the last of my brandy, and suddenly the meaning of what Joseph had said exploded in my brain, snapping me out of my thoughts. Eh? What? Joseph, did you say you were bankrupt? I gasped.
That's right, Carl,
he said grimly.
And unless I come up with money, a great deal of money, I'll lose the house, everything.
Why so glum, Joseph? I laughed. We're old friends. I'd gladly lend you whatever you'll need to see you through.
Don't be silly, Carl,
he said sarcastically.
I have no intention of borrowing any money from you. Instead, I'm taking it, your whole fortune, because in a few seconds, you'll be dead. You see, I've poisoned your brandy. The brandy snifter slipped from my hands and shattered on the floor. I staggered to my feet. I felt weak and dizzy, and my arms and legs were tingling, growing numb. Joseph, I gasped. No, you couldn't.
Oh, couldn't I, Carl?
He snickered. I looked around. Everything began to spin, blur.
If you're looking for the servant, he's not here. I gave him the night off.
I started toward the door at the far end of the room, Joseph's laboratory.
Don't bother trying in a medic, Carl.
He laughed.
The poison is a fast-acting one. It wouldn't help you.
Suddenly, I felt an excruciating pain in my chest. I was halfway across the room when I simply collapsed to the floor. I tried to move. I tried to speak, but it was no use. It was as though I were completely paralyzed.
Goodbye, Carl,
I heard Joseph say,
and thank you for the inheritance.
He came and stood over me. I could see clearly, yet I could not move my eyes. They were glued in that one position. Joseph moved into my line of vision and knelt beside me. I could feel him lift my limp hand, press his fingertips to my wrist.
No pulse,
he whispered. Then he laughed.
You're dead, Carl. Stone dead. And I'm rich again.
Dead? How could I be dead? I could still see, still feel, still hear. I could hear Joseph walk to the phone, lift the receiver, and dial the number.
Hello? Norton Funeral Home?
Yes,
that you, Ben?
Yeah.
This is Doc Fairbanks. You'd better get over here and bring your wicker. Old Doc Winston just died.
No.
Yes, at my house.
How did it happen?
A heart attack.
I heard Joseph hang up. I heard his footsteps approach. I saw his face when he leaned over me. His leering face.
Poor Carl,
he sneered.
How we used to argue about silly theories, about theories that I never really believed myself. But I never could get you angry enough, could I, Carl? I never could get you so upset you drop dead. No, I had to poison you to get your money.
Oh, Lord, what was he saying? Thinking I couldn't hear him? Knowing I was dead? What was my best friend, my old friend, dear Joseph, saying to me as he grinned down and bragged?
It will be so simple, Carl. I'm a physician. I'll sign the death certificate. Heart failure. Death by natural causes. No one will question a surgeon's word. No one. And when the will is read, I'll sob quietly and mourn your passing.
The front door bell rang, and Joseph went to answer it. Ben Norton came in, looking very sad.
It was awful.
Joseph shook his head.
Awful. 1 minute, sitting there, sipping his brandy. The next minute, dead.
How'd it happen, Doc?
Ben asked.
His heart,
said Joseph.
We were arguing about a magical theory of mine. Carl began shouting. I always used to warn him about becoming emotionally upset. But this time, well, it just went.
Too bad. Such a nice guy, too,
sighed Ben.
Well, I'll get his body on downtown.
I'll go with you, Ben,
said Joseph.
And, oh, since I'm the only one in the world Carl had, no family, you know, there's no use dragging this out. Arrange for a small dignified funeral for tomorrow.
Sure, Ben nodded. Why waste time? Come on, lend me a hand. I've got the wicker in the truck.
You who are reading this story, how can you understand how I felt? How can you know the horror that crept up my rigid spine? I was dead by all standards, and yet I could feel, could see, could hear. I could hear them come in with the creaking wicker. I could feel them lift me. I could see things move past my line of sight as they carried me to the waiting basket coffin.
Yup,
Ben the Undertaker was saying.
Old Doc Winston was sure a nice guy.
I could see them looking down at me as I lay stiffly in the wicker. But I couldn't blink, couldn't move an eyelid or a finger or a toe. I couldn't do anything except lie there. I was dead, never to live again, ever.
Look, Ben, his eyes.
Yeah, Doc, I know. They're open, almost like he was seeing us, eh? Well?
Ben reached down, and I felt his fingertips touch my eyelids, pushing them closed. And now I was shrouded in the darkness of death. I could imagine what was happening. I could feel them lift the wicker, carry it outside. They were putting me into the back of the black panel truck with the curtained windows.
Easy now.
I could hear Ben say.
Why?
Joseph laughed.
He can't feel the bumps.
I could hear them get into the front seat. Hear the door slam shut. Hear the engine start. I could feel the motion of the hearse as we drove down into town to the funeral parlor. We rode for a while, and then the truck squealed to a stop. There was a moment of silence.
Well?
Joseph said.
Here we are.
Help me get him out,
Ben answered.
I might as well get right to work on him if you want that funeral in the morning.
I could hear the rear doors of the hearse open again. I could feel the wicker being lifted and carried into the silent white room with the needles and jars and tubes. I could smell the cheap perfume that tried to hide the odors of formaldehyde and death.
Put it down right here,
Ben said softly.
Wait,
Joseph grunted. The wicker lid creaked open. I was lifted out onto a cold, flat surface, a marble table.
I'll get things ready,
said Ben.
Care to watch?
I don't mind,
Joseph answered, a trace of eagerness in his voice. I could hear the rustling whisper of hoses, the sharp clinking of bottles, the hum of a pump motor starting. Ben was getting ready to embalm me. I wanted to scream, to cry out, to beg them to stop. But dead men don't scream. Dead men don't cry out. Dead men only lie stiffly listening, feeling, and crying out inside.
First we drain the blood,
said Ben. I felt what must have been a needle entering my arm, but there was no pain. Joseph had been wrong in his theory, for there was no pain, even as the last drop of blood dripped out of my body and I heard it gurgling down a drain somewhere.
Now we pump in the embalming fluid,
said Ben. Another pump began to hum. Another needle pressed into my dead flesh. More gurgling.
I'll see about a coffin,
said Ben.
Not too expensive now,
said Joseph.
Well, Carl was a plain man. A plain coffin would be most fitting.
That cheap old bat. Joseph didn't want to see any of his inheritance wasted. Ben went out of the room and came back dragging something.
How's this one? Plain pine, satin line. Huh? The cheapest one I've got,
he said. It echoed hollowly as he dropped it.
That'll do fine,
said Ben. I felt myself being lifted again, placed into the coffin. I could feel the smooth satin against my dead hands, the camphor newness, the closeness around me.
There,
said Ben.
That will do till morning.
I'll run along now, said Joseph. You will arrange everything, a simple service, the plot.
Footsteps echoed away. The mortuary door shut. A key rattled in a lock. Silence closed in. How long I lay there, I do not know. Perhaps time to one who is dead is immeasurable. The next thing I remember was the lid being slammed down and Ben's voice.
All right, hand me the hammer.
I lay in the satin darkness while Ben nailed down the lid of the coffin, and the hammer blows echoed around me like a final drum roll. This was to be my funeral, and I was to hear and feel it all.
The chapel is full.
That was Joseph's voice.
We're ready to begin.
I felt myself being moved again. Being rolled down a long hall to where lilies and crepe rustled. A voice began, droning monotonously, my funeral oration.
And so, in parting,
it echoed into the morning chapel.
We can bow our heads in solemn remembrance of Dr. Carl Winston. He lived, he died, but his memory, his work live on after him in our hearts.
The sensation seemed to come quicker now. The voice stopped. Footsteps skidded past the coffin. An occasional sob. I was being moved again. The sound of a motor filtered through to me. The motion of riding. Then the coolness of open air. The voice once more.
Ashes to ashes, dust to dust, lower the coffin.
The scraping of my coffin being lowered, the footsteps crunching away, the sound of a spade and dirt, the hollow boom of dirt crashing down above me on the coffin lid, the horror of it, the helpless, silent, screaming horror of it. But now, suddenly, the shoveling has stopped. There is laughter around, and voices. Ben's voice.
All right, Doc, that's enough. It's almost time, isn't it?
And Joseph's voice answered him.
Almost, open it up.
I hear the lid creak open. I feel the rush of fresh air caressing my face.
Carl!
Joseph is bending over me.
Are you convinced? Carl, you can hear me. I know you can. Are you convinced now?
Open his eyes, Doc. Let him see.
Fingers touched my eyes. I looked up into the night sky, filled with a million twinkling stars. Joseph's face cuts across them, blocking them out. He smiles at me.
You're not dead, Carl. Not dead at all. You've been paralyzed by a new type of anesthetic. That was what I put into your brandy, not poison. You're alive, Carl.
Ben Norton is beside Joseph, grinning stupidly.
We staged this, Carl. The whole thing. Ben and I together. You're not in any cemetery. You're in the garden in back of my house. And it isn't even morning yet.
I lie there in the coffin listening to them, seeing them, Ben and Joseph.
We didn't even take you to the funeral, Paula.
Ben is laughing down at me.
We just put you in the wicker and drove around a bit.
Then we brought you back to my house, to my laboratory.
Joseph adds,
we only pretended it was the funeral parlor.
I lie there, motionless, as they explain.
I brought all the stuff over this evening before you came.
Ben is saying,
the pumps and hoses for sound effects. This coffin. It was a gag, Carl,
says Ben. I wanted to show you that my theory could be right. You almost believed it, didn't you, Carl? Well, maybe now, when we discuss it, you won't be so pig-headed.
Well, Doc,
Ben gasps, staring at his watch.
It's almost 5:30. Shouldn't he be coming out of it?
5:30? That's impossible. The drug was only supposed to last till 5, the latest. Carl?
It's morning now. The stars have gone and I feel the sun on my face. And Joseph is still pleading with me, as he has been for the past 2 hours. The tears in his eyes.
Carl, please, Carl. Come out of it, Carl. It was only a gag. Please come out of it, Carl. Please. Oh, God.
And Ben Norton's face just gets paler and paler as he whispers,
Lord, help us.
Over and over. Poor Joseph and his absurd theory. He wanted so much for me to accept it. And now I have accepted it. Only Joseph will never know. He'll never know how right his theory is. Not until he goes through what I've gone through. For I am dead. I have been ever since the pain in my chest when my heart failed. When I first drank the brandy and Joseph told me it was poisoned.